Thanks for joining us on First Look Asia this morning. A sunscreen is an important part of a skincare routine, but have you thought about whether your sunblock lives up to the claims of protecting you from harmful UV rays?
You might want to take a note because a study in the US this year on 1,700 products found that 80% offer inferior sun protection or contain some worrisome ingredients.
Oh, that, I feel kind of duped, Jen. Anyway, so what do we need to know in order to tell a good sunblock from a bad one? Let's ask Dr. Yvonne Goh, Medical Director at Yvonne Goh Aesthetics. Thanks for being with us this
morning. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us, Yvonne. So when we pick up a bottle of sunblock, the first thing we look at is SPF, sun protection factor. What do we need to know about this?
So SPF factor actually measures the component of the sun, which is mainly UVB rays. It basically indicates how long it takes for skin to get the reddening effects of the UVB rays from the sun, as opposed to without any sunscreen at all.
So when we look at a bottle of sunblock, you know, there's so many of these ingredients we don't really understand. What ingredient is actually the one that works best against UVA rays?
Actually, physical blocks are still the best. Zinc oxide, titanium dioxide. However, these products tend to leave, you know, they're a bit more like, not as elegant as a chemical sunscreen, so they tend to leave a bit of a white residue on the face. So people tend to avoid those and use the newer chemical sunblocks.
But are they as effective?
They are. They're getting better. The new range of the new generation of chemical sunblocks are pretty effective, but ultimately the best UVA, UVB blocks are still the physical blocks.
And you mentioned the face. I've heard that you should use more, I guess, stronger ones on your face versus your body. Is that a myth or is that
true? Well, only because your face is exposed, right? Because when you have protective clothing, that's pretty much covered, and you don't get that much sun exposure. But you should put, and the other thing that people don't know about is that they should actually put ample amount of sun, a thick layer of sunscreen on their face. When I say thick, I mean maybe at least a 20 cent dollop of sunscreen on the face and 2 tablespoons for the entire body. Because all the testings for SPF is based on a very thick layer of sunscreen. And people only apply a fraction of that on the face and on their body, so effectively they're only getting a fraction of the actual SPF value.
So speaking of, like, you know, kind of like slathering on, but what about sensitive skin or irritating ingredients that may be in?
So the chemical sunscreens, the one that apply very smoothly and it's absorbed very well, they tend to have been more irritating on the skin because of the fragrance and the preservatives used. But nowadays there are so many chemicals right now, and with the technology and all the testing done, they're actually pretty good in terms of allergy causing.
Well, what about anything that's labeled hypoallergenic? Is that a misnomer? Like, is that actually for sensitive skin?
I think it just indicates that the testing has been done for allergy. So they've done testing and it has passed the allergy rating.
Okay.
Yeah.
So not exactly that thing.
So what are other ingredients or, you know, words that we should look out for when we're looking at the, you know,
okay. So it's important that to know that SPF only talks about UVB rays. The harmful rays of the sun consists of UVA and UVB. UVB causes sun, is primarily responsible for sunburns. However, both UVA and UVB are responsible for cancer, skin cancer formation and accelerated sun-induced skin aging. So you make sure that when you look at the bottle, you look at the SPF factor. And then there's another one called the protection grade, which comes with like a plus, like they go like plus plus or one plus or five plus. And that talks about UVA protection. So one plus for the minimal protection and five plus for maximum.
So you recommend five? Would you recommend five plus?
Yeah, I mean, most of them you get three plus, four plus is pretty much sufficient.
Okay. Well, you know, we also see these labels like broad spectrum sunscreen. How is that helpful? Would you recommend that?
Yeah, that's actually the optimal kind of sunscreen because it covers against UVA and UVB. So you need both because UVB, although it's, it causes sunburn, but don't forget both of them are responsible for like skin cancer and skin aging. So broad spectrum is the way to go.
Okay, what about the number? That varies, something from as low as 5 to 180. I mean, does bigger
I was
better?
Always taught, like, the higher the number, is better,
right?
Yeah,
is bigger better.
So that's, okay, so that should be clarified. So basically, to make it simple to understand, the SPF number just means the number of times longer it takes for the skin to get burned. So SPF 15 means it will take you 15 times longer to get a sunburn with this sunscreen compared to with no sunscreen. But the I think effective sunscreen block SPF 30 to SPF 50 is probably optimal. Mm-hmm. Anything above SPF 50, there's lack of evidence that it gives you any additional meaningful protection.
It actually makes you think you can stay out in the sun longer, right, with 180?
Yeah. Yes.
That doesn't mean you can be out there for 2 hours?
Yes, it's actually quite bad because it gives the user a full sense of security, prompting mm-hmm. them to stay out in the sun even longer.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So it's actually a
warning.
A warning to be careful.
What about waterproof? What does that mean?
Oh, just water resistant. Right. It just means that it can stay a bit longer if you're swimming or if you're sweating.
Okay.
But ultimately, whatever you use is still advisable to reapply every 2 hours.
Every 2 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. So from what you're saying, the recommendation you're making is between 30 to 50.
Mm-hmm. The spectrum. More pluses, the better.
Yeah, the more pluses, the better.
Yes.
Broad spectrum.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then some waterproof would be good as well.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Let's talk about a trend that's kind of making its rounds: sunburn art or tan tattoos. We have some pictures of this.
Yeah, let's take a look. It's pretty interesting. And disturbing at the same time. Mm-hmm. So, explain a little about this trend that we're seeing, Yvonne.
So a lot of people are trying to stay away from getting permanently tattooed. So they're now heading towards the sunburn tattoo where they put like a pattern like these, and then they just stay in the sun and let the sunburn be the tattoo.
Well, that's creative, the Mona Lisa.
Yes.
But dangerous, though, isn't it?
It is. Mm-hmm. In order to get this sunburn tattoo art, a very high amount of sun exposure is required. Mm. And that is subjecting your skin to like skin cancer formation and sun damage. Ugh. So it's actually very bad for you.
Is there any safe way to get around this?
Sunburn tattoo?
Mm-mm. No, you won't.
Because in order to achieve that sunburn effect, you have to subject your skin to sunburn.
Without any sunblock on it, right?
Yeah, they probably have to put like minimal or no protection to achieve that.
Right.
So that would put you at risk.
Okay. So what are the are there any tips for reversing sun-damaged skin?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are things that you can be done to reverse that. But before we talk about that, we should understand what are the issues we are addressing for sun-damaged skin. So usually it's pigmentation formation, loss of collagen, loss of elasticity, wrinkles, crease formation, right? And then leathery skin texture. Yeah. So with this, we can do like IPL laser toning, which is a rave these days, chemical peels to improve the texture and reduce the pigmentation. Mm-hmm. And then for wrinkles, you can treat the anti-wrinkle treatments like fillers to plump up the lines, replace the volume. Mm-hmm. And then what else? And then that's pretty much. And then a good clinical skincare. You like to fight free radicals and hydrate the skin with multivites, antioxidants.
Well, of course,
that
prevention
can
is always better than having to do all these processes, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But if the sun damage is already done and you can't avoid staying out of excessive sun exposure, then at least there's something that can be done about it.
Yeah.
Right?
What about people who, but genetically darker skin tones? Are they, are they more protected against the sun?
In general, the fairer the skin type, the more susceptible you are because they lack a protective melanin. Mm-hmm. So the darker, you're less susceptible, but still requires sun protection.
Mm-hmm. Well, the dangers, of course, is skin cancer. We've been talking about the damage from the sun because of that. What signs can we look for example? Because, some people talk about a mole mm-hmm. that gets bigger. What kind of signs would you give our viewers?
Okay, an easy way to remember is A, B, C, D, E. So if you see an abnormal mole with asymmetry, B, borders that are irregular or jagged, C, color variation, so if there are two or more colors in a mole, D, if the diameter is more than 6 millimeter, and E, an evolving mole. So if the mole is growing very quickly and there are changes in the color and shape, or if it starts bleeding, then one should get that checked out.
Okay, I like that, A, B, C.
Yeah, easy to remember.
Easy to remember, yeah. Okay.
All right.
All right, thanks for those tips, Yvonne. Thanks for having
me. Pleasure.
For joining us on the show.
All right, well, that was Dr. Yvonne Goh, of course, with an important lesson to read the fine print, or at least stay out of the sun and protect yourself. Medical director at Yvonne Goh Aesthetics. And